Welcome to the Masters of Beautiful Achievements podcast, where we share the insights from inspiring masters about how the use of physics, biology, and green chemistry is shaping our future. It's all you need to know about innovation and better business models. The podcast is hosted by Alexander Prince, founder of Scope Matters. For more inspiring episodes, visit the Masters of Beautiful Achievements website. Today's episode is part of a special series where we look at microbes through a different lens. We will explore how life sciences, biotechnology, and environmental sciences are influencing how we look at our natural world. During this series, Alexander Prinsen and Mark van Bemmel are curious to know what happens when we zoom out and look at microbes as important players in a much broader system. How does this different perspective influence on how we look at the role of microbes and viruses in the web of life? And what lessons can we draw from nature's logic into making our world more sustainable? Together with specialists in the field of virology, microbiology, and biochemistry, we go on a journey combining insights from various disciplines to learn about the essential questions we might have been overlooking. And who knows, we might discover one or two innovative applications along the way. This series is brought to you by Scope Matters, a systemic innovation agency from Rotterdam, the Netherlands. They accelerate business leaders through systemic innovation by merging ecological thinking with economic doing. Their system approach transforms and improves the business model of the clients by creating new opportunities, mitigating risks, and increasing cash flows, while at the same time eliminating waste and doing good. It is the space where systemic sustainable thinking meets circular innovation, because in the end, all matter counts. Check out their website on www.scopematters.com. And Orvion, a young biotech company based in Stolwijk, the Netherlands. They study microorganisms and are developing their own DNA analyzing techniques, like for instance the Orvion U-Detect. They work on solutions to remove contaminants from ground, water or industrial processes more cheaply and permanently. Their services are available for water treatment, soil remediation, ecology and industry. Orvion believes nature can do a much better job, so please take a look on their website on www.orvion.nl. In this episode, we will be investigating why microbes can crack even the most difficult and stable natural and man-made molecules such as benzene, naphthalene and PFAS. Why and how do they do that? And what can we learn from microbes to improve our current energy wasting chemistry? Today, we invited Jan Gerritsen from Deltares. Jan, could you please tell a little bit more about yourself very briefly?
Hi, I'm Jan Gerritsen. I'm a microbiologist and a researcher at Deltares, and I'm interested in microbes degrading things. So microbes can degrade organic contaminants like oil and tar and gasoline and solvents in the environment, but they also can degrade plastics or asbestos and even steel. So that's what I'm investigating in.
And Mark?
Yes, I'm a founder and owner of Orvion. Orvion is a young biotech company based in near Gouda. And in our laboratory, we study these organisms that degrade all kinds of stuff. And we analyze them mainly with DNA techniques. So we have a close look at the bacteria by looking at their DNA. And we are involved in a lot of applications of biotechnology on a big scale. So.
And the topic of this first session will be microbes can crack even the most difficult and stable molecules such as benzene, naphthalene, and PFAS. We will explain later what that means and why, how do they do that, and how and what can we learn from the microbes to improve our current energy wasting chemistry. So we are extremely glad to have you here, Jan, in this session. What is PFAS to start with?
PFAS, well, that's a compound that's used to make cooking pans. It's Teflon. Mm-hmm. So it's made to be very resistant and difficult to degrade. So that's its purpose. And it's a compound with a lot of fluor in it. So that makes it even harder to degrade.
Fluorine?
Yeah.
What is fluorine?
What is fluorine? Where?
Fluor that you use for your teeth, huh, to make strong teeth. You can make strong pens with that.
Oh, that's interesting. Because and what is the purpose of fluorine in nature? Fluorida.
Well, I don't know. I think hardly any. Do you know, Mark? Not really.
There are very few natural occurring fluor organic molecules. I'm not that sure about that. It's really a man-made compound, Alexander. So it's something that has been designed in the 50s in the.
Yeah.
To be very stable over long time. It's even called everlasting compounds. So they were made to be forever chemicals. But the problem is that they are very resistant to heat and all those kind of things, which are very positive for us. But also when they get into the environment, they have very nasty effects on the long term. And even in very low concentrations already. And that's a big problem because these compounds turn up everywhere on Earth now, and especially in drinking water and so on. So they can have negative effects on our immune system and cause cancer and that kind of stuff. So
looked up on the internet, and fluorine is in form of fluorida is considered to be a micronutrient for human health.
Yeah, but in these molecules, so it's a carbon backbone, so it's a long chain of carbon that's completely filled with fluorine atoms. Okay. And that's a very stable molecule. You probably know the CFCs that were causing the ozone threat, ozone layer threat. These are a bit comparable because they have a carbon backbone and they have fluorine and chlorine around them, and they're very stable molecules.
Yeah, we call these compounds xenobiotics. So exactly. So strange to life. So life is not used to these compounds. So they also don't know. Microbes don't know how to degrade them because they don't know it. So you have to evolve and learn how to degrade such compounds. Xenobiotics. Yeah.
And the very interesting thing is that these xenobiotics, so man-made compounds that do not occur in nature, that's in. After a while that these compounds are in nature, that the microbiology finds a way to crack them, to crack the molecules, to eat it and to degrade it. So that's the case for carbons with chlorine on it or fluorine on it. And that's of course extremely interesting because these compounds are so toxic also.
Are you saying it correctly, Mark, that nature is discovering how to break down these man-made molecules?
Yes, absolutely. And we don't know how this works, I think. Maybe Jan has a has a bit more of a theory about that. But
we have to think why they do it, eh? Because they must have a reason to do that. And microbes, they degrade these compounds because they need to live. They need a source of energy, and they need a sort of nutrients like us to live and to grow, to multiply. And that's why they do it. So most of these compounds, they can be used like we eat a piece of cake or a toasty or whatever. We eat it, we chew it, and then we burn it with oxygen. And by doing that, we can use the energy, which is released by burning the toasty with oxygen, which we do in our cells. We store it chemically, and that's what we live, we used to live. And microbes do similar things, only they don't eat toasties and don't always use air, oxygen. But they do use these organic compounds. Sometimes they use it as a toasty. Then it's a source of electrons and energy. And sometimes, like the fluorated compounds, they use as a way of air. And so they use the fluorine to burn other substrates. And that's how this works. So they just are looking for an energy source and a way to live. And if there are new energy sources, they have to adapt to be able to use that.
Has science figured out how? I know that bacteria use hydrogen as an energy source. They can use electrons as an energy source.
Yeah.
Oxygen sometimes as a catalyst.
Yeah, well,
It's interesting that you come up with hydrogen, but because of these anaerobic, so the bacteria that live without oxygen, and some that can dechlorinate, so get chlorine off these carbon, they actually use hydrogen as a source of energy. And yep. There are other bacteria that provide the hydrogen, and these detoxifying organisms actually use the hydrogen to crack the molecule.
And how does these bacteria then use the fluorine? It's
Okay. The way that they do it, they don't use the fluorine.
Sorry?
They don't use the fluorine. They need to get rid of their electrons. When you ate a cookie, you want to have the electrons from the cookie, so that's your energy source, or like the wood. But when you want to burn wood, you need oxygen to get it burning. So you have to blow in air or whatever. Mm-hmm. So and the way that works is that the cookie is degraded and gives electrons, and you have to get rid of these electrons to produce energy. And to get rid of electrons, you need something that accepts that. And when you have a molecule with a lot of fluorine in it, then it's able to accept a lot of electrons. That's done because the fluorine is then released and the electrons are taken up. But they need it to breathe. So need these compounds to breathe.
That's so interesting, because there is a startup from Wageningen or Scale-Up now. What was it called? They use the electrons in the soil to light LEDs. I think the first highway has now already been completed, where they use the electrons in the soil to power the streetlights. Microbial fuel cells.
I wrote a patent on that in 2002.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Tell us more about it.
That's a different story, but it's all the game is really the game with the electrons. That's what life is about. So you have to do reactions, to have an energy source and something that accepts these electrons. And by combining that, by doing that in a subtle way, you can tap off these electrons from the reaction and use that. For example, you make ATP, and ATP is a chemical compound. It's used by life to do many things. It's an energy source. That's how microbes do that. And to be able to do that, they need enzymes. So to degrade certain compounds, you need maybe 10 or 15 or 20 enzymes, like the ones in your washing powder. And they are specially meant to do a certain reaction. So if you have a certain specific compound, you need an enzyme that's able to do a first reaction step, which cracks this compound, which breaks it down. And then you need another one and another one and another one. And so it's quite a complicated pattern, which has to be followed. Yeah. For microbes to be able to live this way. When there is a new compound, you have to design a new enzyme to be able to crack it.
Exactly fits the compound, because it's almost like a key to a lock. It must fit exactly. So if your compound is only slightly different, it doesn't fit into the molecule that the enzyme makes, it doesn't work anymore. So these bacteria that can degrade these xenobiotics, they must have a way to design new enzymes in a way, or they have a specific enzymes in store that do fit on these xenobiotic compounds after some adaptation, maybe.
That is sort of a revolution. If
that's bacteria, life.
true, but it's been to create an enzyme specific for a task that is that requires so much innovation and iteration and I don't know, insights to make it work. And an enzyme is not cheap for a bacteria to make it. I mean, it's not that you'd like, okay, let's create 50 million enzymes to do the job.
Let's see which one works.
Yeah.
but it's not like creating from scratch. Eh? So often you have an enzyme that works on a certain molecule. Mm-hmm. And then when another molecule which resembles the molecule that the enzyme is meant for is present or introduced by humans, they only have to modify it a little bit. Eh? So for example, they have to modify the place where the molecule fits for the reaction and things like that. So very often it's only slight modifications that are needed. And microbes are very clever. They all often have these enzymes. It's coded in the DNA. And the DNA gives all the information how to make such an enzyme. And very often these enzymes, they're in pieces of DNA which can be exchanged between different types of bacteria.
Plasmids.
So they learn from each other.
Mm-hmm. So basically, what you're saying is you have a group of bacteria together. They find a new compound, and basically they attack it together to figure out how to crack.
Yeah, they can share it. Yeah, and then you get more evolution, and it gets better and better. But also, you can get more microbes that know how to do it and spread. Yeah.
So if I want to unlock a lock, I need just to have a lot of bacteria.
Yeah. What's also interesting about this is that, for instance, these xenobiotics, some of them we know have been made from, for instance, 1950 or so. Yeah, so they're relatively new molecules, very new molecules. And then in the 1990s or so, we already find that bacteria can crack these molecules, and worldwide even. So you can find these bacteria almost on every continent. So how does that work? This information exchange or spreading?
To give you an answer on that, I checked on some research, and benzene is a natural component in petroleum in fossil fuels. It's a natural component in oil. Let's put it that way. And oil can be broken down by bacteria. We know that from the oil.
If you take a sample from anywhere, like in your garden or whatever, and you put it in a microbial medium that they like to grow in, and you give them benzene, they will degrade it rapidly when they have oxygen, for example.
But that is weird.
It will be gone in a few days.
Because benzene is not an easy molecule. I mean, it has double line. It's what I know from my chemistry. Long time ago, double bonds
and so on. Yeah.
The double bonds are very tight and tough and not easy to break down.
Yeah, when you have oxygen, it's a lot easier because it can directly react and with this aromatic ring, as it's called.
Yeah, that's the word. Yeah.
If you do not have oxygen, then it's much more difficult. But microbes find solutions for that, and oxygen is only available above ground and so on, but when you're really in the soil, there's no oxygen. So
and toluene and xylene, are there also natural occurring molecules?
Yes, they also occur naturally, but not at very high amounts and concentrations, but they do exist. Yeah,
it's interesting because that is most of the time also a waste stream with oil refineries. I mean, it's in the soil, contaminated soil.
Yeah, what's interesting also about these oils, we had this very big oil spill, I think, in the Mexican Gulf about 10 or 20, 15 years ago. I don't recall exactly. And there was a big, very big layer of oil on top of the sea floating. And all of that is gone. So there was many tons, I don't know how many, but of this oil floating on top of the sea. And what the microbes also do, they do not go into the oil, but they go into the interface of the oil and the water, and they make surfactants, for instance, to make small droplets of the oil, so that they can actually attack the oil from more, they create a lot more surface by cracking the oil into many, many small bubbles.
But, so, it, uh,
But that so they means make that, it and then they can actually much more effectively degrade the oil.
But are you also saying that we actually have natural surfactants available in nature from bacteria? I mean, could we use a lot of synthetic?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Yes. Didn't you know that, Alexander? No.
You make the surfactants yourself in the gall, eh?
What?
Yeah.
You make surfactants yourself. I don't know the English word, but in the gall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, that's a new one. I mean, I've been a while in the cleaning agent business because I know that you can ferment plant stem juice. So the water in plants, you can cold press it, and you have this. Then you have this the fibers in the water. And we're now fermenting the water, which contains all the minerals. And one of the things the cleaning business has a challenge with is that a lot of these surfactants are synthetic and they need to move to more natural ones. And the only ones that exist are those from bacteria. The biggest challenge then is how to keep these surfactants alive for the purpose you want them for. But it's interesting that... Mm-hmm. Sorry, Mark?
And how to produce them effectively, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, and efficiently, but it's cool. But surfactants and biofilms, is that also correlated?
I don't know.
And if you have a lot of bacteria together, they create their own biofilm and
polymers, yes. So these biofilms are like glued together with many different types of polymers.
The
surfactants are more made to dissolve these things, like rhamnolipids they're called, but they're very big soapy like compounds. They produce, they excrete it.
So the interesting stuff is that all these toxic environmental threatening compounds, bacteria find ways to attack them. And there are also bacteria that can sense a certain toxic compound and then move towards it to degrade it. So like the Geobacter species that can also degrade certain chlorinated solvents.
Because Mark, part of your business is also to do soil remediation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I assume also remediation of this shitty molecules. Which had like a little bit of concentration.
Yeah. And the way we do that is, let's start from with one of the problems that is very common, is that we used to have a lot of dry cleaning sites, dry cleaning factories, small family-owned factories in the cities that cleaned your clothes. And they used a certain solvent, and usually that was called per or perchloroethylene, and it's a chlorinated solvent, and that has been used a lot. And the when the perchloroethylene was too dirty, it was used too often. It was usually disposed through the sewers, but the sewers are always leaking, so the tetra got into the soil. On almost all of these sites. I think in the Netherlands there are 10,000 of them.
Oh wow.
And these chlorinated solvents have spread with the groundwater and created mobile groundwater contaminations. And actually these compounds can be degraded by very specific bacteria called reductive dechlorinating bacteria. And those are quite very highly specialized bacteria, and they use these compounds to breathe on, like Jan explained, and we have to put the hydrogen in that they need as an energy source, and we do that in the way of adding lactic acid and that kind of compounds. So the way we do it is we pump up water from this. From this contaminated groundwater, we add the bacteria and the lactic acid and put it back into the soil and mix it in the soil, and then the bacteria start to grow and start to degrade these contaminants. And they do it quite efficiently. They do not grow quickly, by the way. They grow quite slowly. But after, for instance, half a year to a year, you can have almost complete removal of your contaminant. So your contaminant is degraded to a compound that's no longer harmful.
And the funny thing is,
on a very large scale and many.
Yeah. The funny thing is, how did this occur? How do we know how to do this? And it was in the 80s that we found out that microbes were able to do this. And then the late 80s, 1990. Mm-hmm. We thought, hey, when they can do this, we could apply it. So we did a test in the Netherlands, and it was the first one in the world ever, where we just pumped into the soil methanol. we got that done, and by doing that, we showed that one of these dry cleanings, well, it could be the soil could be cleaned within a few months. That worked, and everybody saw that, and now it's a real industry. But that was really the first time, and that was really fun because you are working in a lab. I was a small student there, walking with bottles with dirt and with just sludge through the lab, and people looking, hey, what's he doing?
Yeah.
But in the end, that's really worked out very well because you have an idea and you see that microbes can do this, and then you try to apply it and you're really amazed because it works. And an application you do that together with engineering firms, people that know how to handle groundwater and so on. And then you see all these companies doing these things. And nowadays it's more or less standard technology.
Yes.
Worldwide. And it's really fun. And the basis was just learning how microbes work, how they do it, and why they do it, and then exploit it, use it.
Are you also using them multiple strains, or you mean like
Well, in many cases, you have specific strains that can do specific things, and you see them all the time coming back. Yeah, for example, for PCE degradation, you see maybe two handfuls of different species involved. But subsurface, microbes work together in consortia. So one microbe is producing an energy source for another one, and that is then being used by removing the chlorinated compounds. And so they really work together in consortia. Yeah.
And how do you keep them alive? Because sometimes one want to dominate the
you
other
give
one.
Give them food. Feed them. And then they grow for you. Yeah, you have to do nothing.
But sometimes the pH level also depends whether
you have to keep an eye on things. Things like pH, but in Holland that not often is a problem, but also nutrients. Sometimes they need an energy a nitrogen source. We give our plants, we give them pokon. Well, they need also things like that. But in general, when you give them an energy and a food source, they will just grow and think for you.
And bottom line, it's very simple technology. You pump up water, you throw in some food and some bacteria if it's needed, if they're not there by nature.
Yeah.
And then you wait. And it's a lot cheaper and a lot more sustainable than just pump and have the water treated.
There's two questions coming up in me. One of them is the way you guys explain this. That also means that when people treat contaminated soil, it is actually full of nutrients for microbes, is what I'm getting from you guys. So there's no need to discard them in one big, I mean, Rotterdam has one big place somewhere in the port. I think it's like, it's very deep, and they dump everything in which is environmental unfriendly. Yeah. And if I'm hearing the way you're talking, guys, it's one big battery where microbes can have fun.
No, microbes will not solve all problems and degrade everything. There are certainly limits. When you really have like a place where you have so much contamination, like former gas factories and so on. That's just maybe 8 million kilos of tar in the soil. Well, of course, that's not degraded easily. Yeah? Mm. But when you have a moderate amount of contamination dissolved in the groundwater, then microbes in many cases can degrade it naturally, or yeah. you have to help them a little bit.
But I mean, also that for, let's say, for a gas station that is shut down and need to be moved. I mean, there's a lot of contamination also in the soil there.
Yeah, exactly. And what you often see is that they remove the big source. And then after that, the microbes can take care of it. When you have a big amount of gasoline or oil or whatever in the subsurface, you can imagine that the groundwater that passes that takes up a lot of these compounds. They dissolve slowly in the groundwater and then they form a plume. And that can be hundreds of meters long, sometimes a kilometer, or maybe a dozen meters. But this plume, in many cases, can be controlled by the microbes. Of course, you can sometimes also remove this pure stuff, but then you need really you have to pump in train wagons of food. You have to pump in similar amounts of electron acceptors or donors, things they need to breathe or whatever. So that's not really a very good solution often. But the dissolved contamination, in many cases, they can take care of the microbes. Yeah.
Yeah, and what you see nowadays, what we've learned, I think, by applying the biological methods, is that it is wise to look first what nature can do for your contaminant and for your specific situation. So if you learn, because, for instance, when we just started soil remediating in Holland, then a lot of water was pumped up, or a lot of ground was dug up and thrown into these depots that you meant, Alexander. And now we try to minimize those things and look first, okay, what can nature do on the longer term? And can we use that? If so, then we can actually do less or nothing at all in some cases. So we have to turn it around. Look first to the system. What can nature do it by itself? How can we help that process in a way, stimulate it slightly and then reach the same goals that we want, using a lot less digging and pumping or a lot less energy. And I think it's a way we can look at things also in other, for other purposes. So we can have a look, how does nature do it? How can we do it in another way?
How does it translate to you, Jan, in your work field as for Deltares? Because Deltares is focused on is a water related research institute, isn't it?
Yeah, we work on water, soil, and infrastructure in the Netherlands. And what we try to do is keeping Netherlands safe, clean, and dry. Enabling Delta life is our motto. But we're not like a company that does remediations, but what we do is we develop methods and techniques and we test them to make new innovations. So we do the research which can be used to make new industry, new applications and things like that.
Can you give some examples?
What do you say? Sorry?
Can you give us some examples?
Some examples. For example, I just gave one with the innovation of bioremediation techniques stimulating PCE degradation, but also depending on different compounds, you need different conditions to degrade compounds. So we study the microbes involved in degrading these compounds. We try to understand them. And then we apply things in the field. We make the conditions suited for them. And then we go to industry and companies to do it together. So we do not do that only ourselves. Mm-hmm. And also, like, for example, now we know that many contaminations in the subsurface are degraded. We didn't know that before. So we also studied the subsurface and the behavior and the fate of contaminants there. So
for the listeners, what is subsurface?
The underground. So when you have for example, a chemical plant, and they have all these tanks, these silos, in the bottleneck area. Well, these things, they leak, and also they sometimes leak. I should not exaggerate. So, but things occur, and an underground pipeline may leak. So you get a lot of contamination in those cases in the underground, and then you can think about maybe to 30, 40 meters deep.
Okay.
And to give an idea, and we want to know what's happening then. Are there microbes that can degrade it or not? And can we measure that? Can we show that they are doing that? And if you can show they do it, maybe it's best to just leave it there, because if you get it all up, also people will be exposed to these compounds. So maybe better not, but it depends on the situation. For example, when you have a drinking well nearby and the groundwater is going that way, you better do something about it. So there you have to really take care that it doesn't
quickly.
Yeah.
You're putting forward a very interesting paradigm. Petrochemistry, the petroleum industry has these tanks, and issues occur and leakage is happens.
Well, not daily, but that's
but it happens,
we try to prevent it.
It does happen, but it does. But the way you mention is that although they're using fossil dead organisms, their allies are living organisms. So the contamination that has been accumulated could be mitigated by actually injecting microorganisms, and they clean the stuff, they clean the soil while the operation is still going.
Yeah, but in many cases you don't have to do anything also.
Yeah,
because the conditions are really suited and good for the microbes to do their work, and they're in many cases already there. When you have an oil field, it's full of microbes. They live there. That's their niche. That's the place where they live.
So if I would have an oil refinery or a oil related storage facility, I could put in my my sustainability report that we have discovered new microbes eating away the pollution, and the soil is in good health because the microbial flora is thriving.
What is important is to demonstrate, to show by research, and Mark does that, and we also try to find out how to do it. You have to show that these microbes are helping you to stop the spreading of the contamination. The contamination doesn't go everywhere. It stays on the site, and in the end, maybe it will disappear. And you have to prove that, to show that. That's very important.
The interesting stuff is we can prove it nowadays with these DNA techniques. I showed you these microbial profiles, Alexander. So we can look at the complete population of bacteria that are present in a contaminated ground. And then we can actually see if there are bacteria growing that can do something about that. And for instance, at the gaswork site in Hilversum, we did that. And we could show that this naphthalene that is present there is actually degraded, and that you could use this natural process to remediate, to get rid of it in the long term.
To get things straight, when something is degraded, microbes break down all the bonds, so you get the carbon, you get the nitrogen, you get all the other molecules.
You get CO2 and water. Maybe some chlorine, but you get the minerals.
That's amazing. But it sounds like for me it sounds like magic. In that case, and Mark, we talked a lot about the microbial population known to human, and I think it's still 8%, 5% is still known. In your field, Also for Jan, are you still discovering new ones?
Yeah, we now and then discover new ones. And in many cases, these discoveries are also based just on DNA. So we don't have them in our hands. We don't grow them in bottles in the field. But with microbes, it's not so easy to define species. So many microbes look very similar to each other, and they differ in many different and very little things. So the definition of species, like we have humans, plants, certain fish, so that's a manfish. With microbes, there will be very many different manfish-like types. So
how do you differentiate them? I mean, how do you know if you have a new one, if it's so tough?
What we do is we analyze the DNA and then we make pictures, and then we make like a tree of life using the DNA.
Okay.
And then you see, okay, this is something really new, really new branch. So okay. we do discover a lot of these small little leaflets. Mm-hmm. And so that's daily, but a whole new branch. Well, that's really rare.
Yeah,
but it does happen.
It does happen. Yeah, it does happen. And so there is a lot to learn, a lot unknown. It's really, really fun. It's really nice.
It's really fun because you're the first one actually looking at such complex microbial populations when you do this. So you always get interesting new stuff, and you always find new things. And what's also nice thing is that a bacteria that has known from this capacity to degrade these solvents from the from the dry cleaners is called Geobacter, and the people that worked on this Geobacter have quite recently found out that it's also can do a lot of interesting things with electricity cables that they create. So I don't know if you know about this, Jan, the work that
I patented it in 2002. Yeah, that's the ones that are in biofuel cells. Yeah, microbial fuel cells. So that's what we found is that microbes have ways to channel electrons. Between, for example, iron or steel, or graphite or whatever. Mm-hmm. So directly, they can make a direct contact, for example, with little antennas that they connect.
Yeah. Like a steel bacteria have those. Yeah.
Stacker and a stop contact.
Yeah.
And then by doing that, they can really, do very important electrochemical things. Yeah, that's quite new, that discovery and how they do it and so on. And we find they're very important also in corrosion processes.
Yeah, and these geobacters can make these cables. These are sort of small wires that transfer electrons in the same way as copper wire, but they are made of protein and they can transfer electrons on centimeters of this cable. So these bacteria they cross distances of centimeters, which is amazing.
Well, they can connect to each other, and then growing together, they can, for example, the ones that are on the top of a sediment, they can use oxygen to breathe, and the ones that are below, they can use organic compounds that are coming up, and then by doing this together, they share the energy.
But it seems that you're talking about mycelium from fungi.
Well, that's maybe a bit similar. They're called cable bacteria, so
But that means that our future batteries could also be made out of their material then. I mean, it has super conductivity. So if we find a way to, synthesize those polymers.
Yeah, an application they're looking at is, for instance, using them in the human body and for doing electrical things. And then after a while, they can be when the stuff has been done, they can just be degraded naturally because they're made of protein, so they can just be taken up by the body without any residue, like copper wire would. And another very interesting thing actually is called a self-powered useful device, SPUD, which you could actually sort of think of. So you could make some kind of micro device that creates its own energy and could also degrade contaminants.
But then the question remains, it needs something to consume in order to survive. I mean, it needs sugars or something.
Yeah, you know that with these biofuel cells, eh? So that's a system where microbes degrade organic material. And I even used French fries from our you're just putting French fries and they degrade it, eh? and then they need to get rid of these electrons again. So yeah. Hey, I'm trying to find a way to get rid of my electrons, and then when you put an electron in there which they can connect to, they just put in the electrons in that electrode. And when you then connect that to a circuit, like making an electrical circuit to another electrode which reacts, for example, with oxygen, you get an electrical circuit and current, and then you can I had a little windmill on it or a lamp or whatever.
Yeah. If I would have a potato factory, which we have quite a lot in the Netherlands, my waste stream could power a microbial fuel cell.
Yes, easily. But the thing is that why don't we have them all already and so on? The thing is that they can make energy, but they don't make a lot. So it doesn't go really fast like megajoules.
I understand, but then I'm more interested in what the cascading is of the microbial flora, because they produce, I don't know, acids or...
And the CO2? In the end, in one, these fuel cells, there are two electrodes separated by a membrane. And in the one electrode, the organic matter is oxidized, as we call. Electrons are loaded into the electrode. They go to the other chamber, and then they react with O2, with oxygen, for example, making water. Okay, when you make... make water, of course, you also you also create a pH difference, and you make also a lot of H+ there, and you consume it there. So that goes through the membrane. So then you have an electrical circuit which is made complete with a diffusion through a membrane, and that's really nice. That works well. It works really, really well. You can easily make it at home. It's no problem. Students made it for their fieldwork and so on. It doesn't go very fast. It doesn't give much energy.
Mark?
And then you get a few volts or so, Jan? Or?
Yeah, well, the reaction you can calculate. Eh? So the reaction between organic matter and O2, that's 0.8 volt normally. You lose a little bit on these electrodes. Mm. So in the end, you have about a half a volt with one cell. Yeah. What I did, I stacked them like batteries. So when you have four, you have 2 volts.
It's a slow process. I think your organic can last quite a long time before it's used up, or?
It depends on what you give them, eh?
Let's say I have a lot of potato waste. how big can you make the battery to make it useful?
Yeah, it has to be very big, and again the problem. So you must think in maybe like hundreds squares of meters, and then you run into costs for electrodes and membranes, and that's the major bottleneck at the moment. It's easier to use the waste to make methane, in wastewater treatments. System and then use methane to make energy. That's much easier.
Yeah, or to use methane to produce biochemicals. Even methane is a food source for bacteria.
The
same with hydrogen.
I have a
final question, because I found on my fact sheet a very disturbing one.
Hmm.
even living organisms are building up PFAS. So even the what is it called, Mark? The P.
Perfluorooctanoic substances.
They even build up in human bodies. So my question is, we were exploring how good microorganisms function and that even our own body makes enzymes. How smart is our own body and our ingestive system to figure this one out?
That's a difficult one.
I don't think it degrades it very well. In the liver, of course, a lot of things are degraded. But these compounds are really nasty ones. Yeah.
But in a human body, I mean, the human consists of microbes. And even in our intestines, it are microbes who are taking out the nutrients to supply it to the human body. So these molecules enter the digestive system, and somehow they are sucked up in the bloodstream.
They're taken up, yeah.
Taken up. So the bacteria don't have enough time to break them all down, I assume.
Exactly.
They would break some down, but not all of them.
We always thought nothing would, until a few years ago, people thought they were not degradable at all. Nowadays, we know that certain bacteria are there that can do something about it, but it is relatively slow, and we do not know that much about it yet. I think fungi. There's a few fungi that can do a bit with it as well.
But those are in our digestive system or outside?
I don't think it has been studied, for as far as I know.
Because one thing I've learned about biologists and soil biologists, they constantly make the comparison between soil and our digestive system. And the bacteria that live in the digestive system are the ones who are the oldest in the world. Because once the big oxidation happened, they had to find a way to secure themselves. And most bio digesters have bacteria that originate either from rabbits or cows or elephants. And Lanzatec, for instance, uses one from rabbits. Because those were the ones who were able to digest CO2, carbon monoxide, and even methane. So the analogy I always make is, okay, if it happens in nature and it exists in soil, then why not does it exist in our own digestive system? Or have we destroyed them because of the food we eat and the biodiversity degrees we're having in our own digestive system?
Of course, our digestive system is only one habitat, eh? And in nature, in the environment, we have many more.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more diverse there than only in our digestive system. So that's one thing. But in general, you can say that many things that occur in the environment also occur in ourselves. You have to imagine that, of course, we don't have, it's mainly methanogenic conditions, which we call it, mm-hmm. in our stomach. Mm-hmm. So we don't have a lot of these electron acceptors which are needed.
Could you explain that difficult word?
Yeah, methanogenic. Eh? So when you don't have any acceptors to breathe anymore, like oxygen.
What's an acceptor?
Things to breathe. Eh? When you don't have any things to breathe anymore.
Yeah.
You start to make methane, like cows.
Okay.
Too much, and so the only thing that you then is left over is often CO2. And then you put your electrons on CO2 and you make methane. And that's what's actually mainly happening also in our stomach and in our cows and many other digestive systems. But in the environment, a lot of these electron acceptors are available. And then you can think about oxygen, but also nitrate, which is a lot in our environment at the moment. Sulfate or iron. We don't have all that in our stomach.
Now, and the interesting thing about this PFAS bacteria that has been described recently, last year, that's completely new discovery of Mr. Peter Jaffe from Princeton University. That bacteria uses iron and ammonia together. So the ammonia is used as an electron donor and it's transferred into nitrite, and the iron is takes up one electron and then is transferred into another state of iron. And at the same time, this fluorine is removed from the molecule for somehow, some reason, which we don't know exactly. No, but it does happen.
Then you know, then you guys know what I would say. Then we have to look at quantum biology to figure that one out.
I don't know. Maybe. Well, we are really only at the very beginning of knowing these species. Actually, we are in a project now in Holland to test about 80 soil samples on the DNA of this recently found bacteria, to see if we have it in Holland as well, because in Holland the PFAS problem is quite significant. It has been in the news almost constantly since last year, until the COVID hit the van, of course. But that is
concentrated in Dordrecht, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's a factory there. Yeah, but you find it everywhere in our rivers.
Yeah.
And how come? Because it's discharge from factories, or
also, but it's in many products. It's like in Gore-Tex and many products. These Teflon things are so.
So I am very happy that I have a sustainable brand as my rain jacket, and then still there is Teflon in it.
Yeah, when it's Gore-Tex, that's Teflon.
Yeah, and it uses fire extinguishing foam and so on.
Yeah.
So
Gore-Tex is not a sustainable solution if you want to make good choices.
Well, it's made of PFAS compounds.
Hmm. It's okay. Yeah. Or a Texas out of the.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Okay. Shall we wrap up? I mean, I think we explored quite a lot, and I learned a lot thanks to you guys. I mean, we found a bacteria that uses iron and ammonia and nitrate to do something. I think that is quite new. Most people in this field know that these are very important molecules, but that even biological life can do something useful with it. I've learned from you, Jan, microbial fuel cell, but in more detail and in more interesting than I ever thought. So maybe we'll see you back another time to explore that in a little bit more detail.
Okay.
It is the future and Mark, the work you're doing, what are your takeouts? I need to digest this again.
Yeah, well, it is a very fascinating world of which we are uncovering more and more on a daily basis, I would say. And people tend to underestimate the power of nature or natural processes. But nature is very smart and has a lot of solutions. By studying it carefully, I think we can learn a lot about how to deal with chemicals, with chemical processes, or with energy efficient chemical processes. If you find the right enzymes, then we can do it at low temperatures, low pressures, and we can do it a lot more efficiently. So we have to look closely at nature and to take the next step, I think.
John?
Yeah, I think so too. It's really fun to study nature and microbes and then see what they do and how they do it. And then thinking about it, hey, how can we apply this and then do something useful for the environment and for people? It's really fun. Yeah. And it's also very nice that you can do this together with universities and companies. So being in between both worlds, that's what I really like.
The best position. Yeah.
You get a, You get the best of two worlds.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jan, for joining us and sharing your insights in this fascinating world. And Mark, it seems that we are on something, and I'm looking forward to the next session we're going to have on this topic.
I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Master Beautiful Achievements podcast. A special thanks to our sponsors Scope Matters and Orvion for making this series possible. If you like our podcast, subscribe in your favorite podcast app. And if you want to know more, do check out the mastersofbeautifulachievements.com website. If you like this podcast, do not forget to leave us a review on your preferred podcast platform. Thank you for listening, and join us next time.